We'd like to thank you for attending this morning, and most of all, we want to welcome you. On behalf of Oakside, Seventh-day Adventist Church, we'd like to invite you to our Sabbath school lesson this morning. And the topic this morning is the Holy Spirit and the Church. And may we focus in prayer this morning that we can be part of this movement. Let us kneel for those that are able. Our Heavenly Father, who art in heaven, blessed be your holy name. We bow before you in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Bless us afresh with thy Holy Spirit. As we enter into thy sanctuary, we ask for your grace upon us. And we thank you for hearing and answering our prayers. Amen. The Holy Spirit and the Church. This is an appeal to the church worldwide, that we ourselves need the Holy Spirit in our church, in our own lives, to finish this work. Our key text this morning is found in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 to 5. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 to 5. In reading, and you're hearing, there is one body, one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. We ourselves have been a people that have been striving to endeavor what is the Bible and what is Jesus Christ and why do I have to serve him? Ephesians 4 verses 3, 4, and 5 and verse 6 in reading, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, there is one body and one Spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one Yahweh, in other words, one faith, one baptism, and one Elohim, and Father of us all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all. This is a blessing that has been given to us in regards to the Holy Spirit, exposing the Father and the Son in regards to the love that he has for each one of us. This morning's topic is the Holy Spirit and the Church that is needed so much today. I want to share with us that our memory text was very, very important. But I want to read, in continuing with our discussion, in Manuscript 55, 1903. I point you to the words of the Apostle Paul in the fourth chapter of Ephesians. This whole chapter is a lesson that God desires us to learn and practice. Manuscript 55, 1903. In this manuscript, ladies and gentlemen, is a foundation that we ourselves can read the whole book of Ephesians. In explaining the means of unity and continuing in this study, we ourselves need the presence of Jesus Christ with us. We need his manifestations of the Holy Spirit working in our lives so that the Holy Spirit can dwell in us, the human being. Not in a building, ladies and gentlemen. The people who keep his commandments is the church. And continuing, in the fourth chapter of Ephesians, the plan of God is so plainly and simply revealed that all his children may lay hold upon the truth. Here the means which he was appointed to keep unity in his church, that its members may reveal to the world a healthy religious experience, is plainly declared. Your reference is Manuscript 67, 1907, in the later years of Ellen White's life, emphasizing the unity of the people in the church. So the Holy Spirit in these last days, in its manifestation, is uniting the people to Jesus. Jesus is the one that gives us the gifts of the Spirit, ladies and gentlemen, and we ourselves come before him. Let us have a word of prayer before I continue. Our Father who art in heaven, in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, we ask for the outpouring of thy Holy Spirit upon us this morning, and we ask for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Give to us thy favor this morning as we ask. In your holy name we pray, amen. And continuing, we have discussed this morning Sabbath's lesson, but I want to go over a phrase this morning on the Sabbath lesson. In reading, sometimes we think of the Holy Spirit at work only on the individual level in the lives of individual believers. And continuing, but this work and individuals is the foundation of spiritual community. The Holy Spirit is ultimately responsible for the existence of the Church of Christ, meaning you, ladies and gentlemen, every one of you around the world that is viewing this morning. The Holy Spirit is in you, driving you and directing you and guiding you in mercy to Jesus Christ, who gives us life. But the Holy Spirit in the church has been lacking. Many of us have been studying this quarter on the early reign of the Holy Spirit, who the Holy Spirit is, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, unity of the church, the word in prayer, that the Holy Spirit can interpret these prayers to our Savior Jesus Christ in the most holy of holies. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7, as we turn to it, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. So our Savior gives us his favor upon our learning and our endurance with him. Once again, but unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. The Lord saw our fallen condition. He saw our need of grace, and because he loved our souls, he has given us grace and peace. That is a blessing. He's given us his grace unconditionally. He's given us his peace, an overwhelming peace, not as the world gives to us, but as he gives to us, and he leaves us his peace. One, grace means favor to one who is undeserving of his favor, to one who is lost. We might be in the church, ladies and gentlemen, but let me share with you that when you go home, his grace is sufficient for each one of us. He is not going to leave us alone. We need his grace, and we need his outpouring of his Holy Spirit. Two, the fact that we are sinners, in plural, instead of shutting us away from the mercy and love of God, makes the exercise of his love to us a positive necessity. In order that we may be saved, your reference in Signs of the Times, June 5th, 1893. Now, I'm going to open up in Sunday's lesson. And I'm waiting for some people to respond with this lesson, because it's a beautiful lesson. It's a beautiful study. The Holy Spirit unites us with Christ. Did you have a response, sister? The Holy Spirit unites us, which is a manifold of his grace upon us. But the most key here is that are we willing to receive? Or have we been afraid of the Holy Spirit? Many people do not receive the Holy Spirit because they're unwilling to give up their preconceived ideas. And when we do that, we give up our own preconceived ideas. Christ is more willing to open up to us his love and his mercy and his grace. Ain't that beautiful? Let me continue. Therefore, Yeshua is responsible for his church, his remnant church, his people. He's responsible for his people. The people in the churches, plural, around the world observe their leaders or their leadership as responsible for the churches, when it is every individual's responsibility within the church. Whether you are in positions or whether you are out of positions, it is every Christian's responsibility in the remnant church, in the sanctuary, to reverence Jesus Christ in love. He's not forcing us. Therefore, it is the Holy Spirit's duty to guide each and every faithful steward in righteousness. However, it is the four angels that are holding back the evils of Satan. They're holding back the winds of strife. Many issues are taking place that our eyes cannot even behold. I'd like to ask a question to us. Has anybody read Ephesians chapter 2, verse 18? If not, I'd like to turn to it. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 18. In reading, for through him, Jesus Christ, we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Ain't that beautiful? We have access to Jesus, to the Father, through the Spirit. That's a blessing. One that we ourselves can promise. It's a promise. We can claim that promise. Question. What do they tell us about the role of Christ and the Holy Spirit in the creation of the church? Through the Spirit, we have access to God, the Father. Jesus is the rock, the foundation of our salvation, and the one upon whom all other parts of the whole building are created, are erected or created. So as we are erected to give him reverence, what is your responsibility? Let's take a pause at this moment. The topic is the Holy Spirit in the church. How can you exemplify their attributes and contribute to unity in the church? Number one, the study talks about doctrines. There is no unity if the doctrines and the teachings that Christ has given to us will never be established in us. You see, there's more light coming. And if we don't break from this square and grab, not the grammar, but that meat of the message, of those doctrines, then we're going to be lacking down here. So when we hear the message coming, the people there are ready. But the people here aren't ready. They were never ready. This is why the leadership has to grow gracefully in grace so that the people can grow. But if they're not growing as they should be, then we have to go back and go back to the milk and feed us again and build us up. That's why the seminar and the spiritual gifts that will be given will help us and enhance us to grow and be where we need to be. Not down here. We are the leaders. We're not the followers. We're the leaders. So when you hear the sermons taking place, it's going beyond your heads. It's because you're not studying. That's why the books that I have here on the table are six books. The Dragon and the Beast. The Mark of the 666. It's all here. And this is why the evangelism on books needs to be done now, not tomorrow. Everything is breaking down. Everything is happening. You're listening to the radios. I know you're watching the TVs. And we're supposed to be away from all that stuff. Well, if you use it for the good purpose of His grace to uplift the church, then it's a blessing. But if we're using it only to stay in the couch potato and just listen to the gossip that's going on, and we're not enhancing and edifying the church. So what good is the Holy Spirit? Remember, the topic is the Holy Spirit and the church. Have you received the Holy Spirit? Our words of communication have to be in honesty, have to be in how Christ would speak. No vulgar communication whatsoever. That's not the Holy Spirit speaking to us. So my question is, how does baptism unite us with Christ, with the Holy Spirit? Come on, let's wake up, ladies and gentlemen. The Holy Spirit unites us with Christ. Ephesians 1, verse 20, 21. Let's go to Ephesians 1, verse 20, 21. The Father gave all honor to His Son, seating Him on the right-hand side, far above all principalities and powers. He expresses great joy and delight in receiving the crucified one and crowning Him, Jesus Christ, with glory and honor, and above all the favors has shown to His Son in His acceptance of the great atonement. And this is where we're at now, ladies and gentlemen. The Day of Atonement, atonement, is a feast. It still exists. Our sins need to be blotted out before that day closes. In April 11th is the Feast of Passover that's coming in. Do you understand what Passover means? Do we understand what happened when Christ was crucified in Nisan 14? He was dead on the Sabbath on Nisan 15? Ladies and gentlemen, this year is very serious. The Holy Spirit in the church is our topic. You, the church, each one of you is the church. And we ourselves have to grow, but without the Spirit, we're not going to grow. Let me read this again. The Father gave all honor to His Son, seating Him at His right hand, far above all principalities and powers. He expresses great joy and delight in receiving the crucified one, Jesus Christ. Welcome. And crowning Him with glory and honor, and above all the favors has shown to his son in his acceptance of the great atonement are shown to his people today. Those who have united their interest in love with Christ are accepted in the beloved. When have you ever read such spiritual prophecy quotations like this? Manuscript 128,
1897.
Yes.
In what way, we could ask ourselves, does the Holy Spirit unite us with Christ?
Good. We're going to get right into it real quick here. Because you got self-supporting ministries, you got the poor person, Seventh-day Adventist Church, you got missionary workers, you got them working all over the place. But everybody wants to go to Hawaii and go surfing. Everybody wants to go to Russia and look at everything that's going out there and go skiing. Everybody wants to go to different countries to do missionary work. But you're forgetting the United States that needs to be re-evangelized and cultivated in medical missionary work, because all hell's going to break loose here in the United States very soon. And without the Holy Spirit in your life and in your family, you are going to have no part in this message. He's looking for people to be sanctified, ladies and gentlemen, and he's looking for people to give and be prepared to give the strict testimony. No playing around no more. It's not about the money, who's going to fund the program. It's not about that. It is about Yeshua HaMashiach being empowered in your lives, in my life, and he's going to use the loneliest of the loneliest. He's not going to use people of an education with a PhD. He's going to use those that are humble and meek. He's going to use the poorest of the poor that have been suffering for employment just to keep up every week. He's not going to use those that are keeping up with the Joneses. Let me share something with you in the Sabbath school lesson. The question is, how does baptism unite us with Christ and with the Holy Spirit? The baptism of the Holy Spirit was given to the apostles in order to empower them. And after they had received the Holy Spirit, they went forward. You all know that in Acts chapter 2 and follow. Matter of fact, the whole book of Acts. But I'll come to that in a minute, but I don't want to supersede you what I'm sharing here. I want to build a foundation. Because all you who are seeing and understanding what's going on, you play a part in last day events. And guess what? You're going to be chosen to be found worthy to speak. And if you don't know the message, you're not going to give the message. You're going to stay in the couch. You're going to stay in your office. They suffer with Christ in his deepest humiliation, and his glorification is of great interest to them because they are accepted in him. God loves them as he loves his son. Can you imagine that same love that he has for his son is the same love he has for Andy, Elizabeth, Mary, Joe, and John, everyone else. And for you who are watching, his same love for Christ is the same love for you. No partiality. There's no favoritism. Christ Emmanuel. Emmanuel means Elohim with us. That's what that word means. Stands between Elohim and the believer. Me and you. You and him. Revealing the glory of Elohim to his chosen ones. And covering their defects. Yes, defects and transgressions that we commit every day. But we have someone that will forgive us of our sins in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of our iniquities, our unrighteousness. This is why he's given us justification. He's given us sanctification. Ladies and gentlemen, we need more of a milder tone here and there once in a while, but when we're coming down to the closing scenes of Earth's history, we have to make sure that we receive the Holy Spirit. Let me read it again. Christ Emmanuel stands between God and the believer, revealing the glory of God to his chosen ones. He's chosen you, my friends, and covering their defects and transgressions with the garments of his own spotless garments. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
That's what we need right now. Can we be willing to say, fill me with your own imputed righteousness, Jesus? Let's have a word of prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, we know that we are sinners. And we ask for you to impute and impart righteousness upon us, that you can remove these filthy rags, that you may find us worthy to give these messages. Bless us this morning on your holy Sabbath. We ask for your virtue upon each one of us. And we thank you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And continuing, the Holy Spirit unites us through baptism. So the question was asked, how do we receive the Holy Spirit, and how do we have unity? So that everyone knows that in the last days, there's going to be a division. And it's already occurring. So with those that have the Holy Spirit, and they're being grounded and studying the doctrines and restudying and studying and restudying and studying feast keepers, Sabbath keepers, birthday keepers, first day, seventh day Adventist keepers. All of you are going to come together and you're going to join the remnant. There's no choice. You only got a choice of life and death. That's it. The same premise, same rule, same principle applies to me. The speakers, the preachers, the pastors, as myself, will be judged first before you. Because we should have warned the flock of what is coming. And if we don't warn the flock and prepare them, guess what? I'm gone. I indeed, and this is John the Baptist, he says, I indeed baptize you with water. Water. Unto what? Ladies and gentlemen, repeat it after me. Unto what? What's it say? Unto repentance. But he, Jesus Christ, who is coming after me, is mightier than I. He says, he's mightier than I, everyone. Christ who's coming is going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire and enable you to give the messages in love, in sweetness. You might find me as an individual that is quick and fast. Yes, I am. But listen, I'm here trying to warn you that it's all over and it's coming, and we need the Holy Spirit in us in order to go through what is happening, what is coming. Peace and safety is coming, ladies and gentlemen. Let me read it once again in kindness. The Holy Spirit unites us through baptism. Here's the first prerequisite in receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit before or after baptism. John says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry, neither is Richard. I'm not even worthy to carry those sandals or to unloose them. He, Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire, enabling you to remove all these preconceived sins that you have in your life.
Amen.
This is the message of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, of a remnant that has come together to go home. We're so infiltrated with so many issues of Jesuits and Catholics. The hell with all that. You need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You need to get your life together, and you need to be part of this remnant and preach this message correctly. This is the whole level of love. Preaching the correct message. It's time to go home. And everything is crumbling, and we see it. Don't depend on Donald Trump to change everything, because it's not going to change. It's going to hell, ladies and gentlemen. It's already been given to us. So if these lesson school studies are not being very helpful for us, then we better find another book. Because the lessons go deeper than this. Sabbath after Sabbath, we come to church and we gather to church. But we want to gather together in spirit, and in truth, and in love. You know, Christ is not scolding us. We scold each other. I don't really want to be scolded to him by a seven last plagues. Let me continue in here. Your references here is in Matthew 3, verse 11, Mark 1, 8, Luke 3, 16, and John 1, verse 33. Continuing, Jesus came to impart to the human soul the Holy Spirit. Look at this love. He came. He gave up his omnipresence. He gave up his position to come in human form, to be found in a trough to the shepherds who were looking for the birth of Jesus Christ. Look at what he did. He came to give to men new hearts. He said, a new heart also will I give you, Richard. Thank you. Ezekiel 36, 26. This is a prophecy, by the way. It goes even deeper. But the self-righteous of that day and of this day feel no need of having a new heart. This is mercy. Today, all over the world, we're studying the ministry of the Holy Spirit that is the key agent in the need to finish this work. But the self-righteous of that day and of this day in 2017 feel no need of having a new heart. Review and Herald, March 20, 1894, paragraph 7. And I'm going to come home with this. There is no power in repentance, ladies and gentlemen, to change the life. Did you hear me? There is no power in repentance, ladies and gentlemen, to change the life. There's no power there. You're only confessing that you're not going to no longer lie. You're not going to bear false witness. You're not going to do things that you shouldn't be doing. going to go and commit adultery? I'm going to read it once again. There is no power in repentance whatsoever to change the life. However, but when the helpless soul, which is me, casts himself unto Christ, now everything changes. Now he gives me his imputed and imparted righteousness. Now he turns around and walks with me so that I can come into the holy place every day and ask him to fill me afresh with his Holy Spirit. We're the last generation, ladies and gentlemen. We're the last people and your children. And we're understanding is the Holy Spirit in the church. What is the Holy Spirit in the church? We don't know because we're not reading the books. But I got books up here for you to take. Books here for you that you yourselves can understand what is being discussed. Books, for example, the dragon, the beast, the false prophet, mysticism, some music, the Illuminati 666 that you want to know about, UFOs and all this other mess, the Antichrist. Who's the Antichrist? The literature evangelist work is going to finish the work. The literature evangelistic workers around the world are finishing the work. And guess what? You will be part of it because you're going to have to give the message. And then in God, I want to give you a set that you can read them in your own free time. That's $70 right there. Who else wants a set? We're going to finish this work, ladies and gentlemen. It's not about coming to church every day and thinking that everything's fine and dandy. We're out there in the streets. We're out there in the city of Washington, D.C. We're bringing people in, but people want to hear the straight message. They don't want to hear no more smooth message. They want to hear, is Jesus Christ, is he loving me? Is he going to love me for all the things I've done? You better believe it, he's going to love you for all the things you've done. He just doesn't love the sin. We grieve the Holy Spirit because we're continuing to live in sin. But let me share with us, is that he loves us with an overwhelming surprise. And you have no idea. There is no power of repentance, ladies and gentlemen, to change the life. But when the helpless soul casts itself on Christ, there comes transformation of character. That means that that person is born again. He's repented. She's repented. The family's repented. We don't got time for smooth sermons. The Savior declares, Richard, a new heart I'm going to give you. Richard, I'm going to give you a new spirit. Everything we're doing, everything we're preaching about, everything we're doing in Sabbath school lesson is being written down by the angels. There's a Holy Spirit on the earth, but there's seven Holy Spirits in the sanctuary in heaven. Did you know that? There's seven spirits in the sanctuary. Let me read it again. The Savior declares, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. That's power. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Because that's what everybody needs in everybody's denomination. So that we can come out of Babylon and be one remnant and go home. Everybody's been asking us, well, how come we haven't gone home? What's been holding us from going home? This is the reason. Because we don't want a clean heart. We don't want a new spirit. Christ, our mediator, is the one who gives the Holy Spirit. And by the office work of the Holy Spirit, listen to this word, office. By the office work of the Holy Spirit, the gifts are coming out through Christ. The atonement made on Calvary is brought in contact with the soul of man to transform his character. Let me read that again. I don't think anybody heard this one. Let me read this again. Christ, our mediator, is the one who gives the Holy Spirit, and by the office work of the Holy Spirit, the atonement made on Calvary, 31 AD, for each one of us, is brought in contact with the soul of man to transform his character and change his nature until it can be said in heaven, we are laborers together with God, wearing Christ's yoke, bearing his burden. Your reference is the youth instructor, July 5th, 1894. So you had a Sabbath school lesson here for the last 24 years, repeating the same thing over and over, but there hasn't been no change. That's my concern, and that's Christ's concern. The new heart and the new spirit has not been asked for. And until we ourselves beg and plead daily for the baptism of the Holy Spirit and receive that transformation of character of Christ in us, the hope of glory, there isn't going to be a change. The Holy Spirit unites the church through the Word of God. In John 5, verse 39, in the Word the Savior is revealed in all His beauty and loveliness. Every soul will find comfort and consolation in the Bible, that's true, which is full of promises concerning what God will do for the one who comes into right relation to Him. Especially will the sick become comforted by hearing the Word, for in giving the Scriptures, God has given to mankind a leaf from the tree of life, and He's only given just a little tat. So all this new light that's coming in right now that everybody's rejecting, guess what? That's the latter rain falling. Intellectual knowledge coming in already. And you're rejecting it because you're not reading the Bible, you're not reading the Spirit of Prophecy, or Testimonies to the Church, or Counsels to Children, or Diets and Foods. And here we have people that are looking for it, people that have a spirit. Are you that church? Amen. Because you are. Let me continue. Especially will the sick be comforted by hearing the Word, for in giving the Scriptures, God has given to mankind a leaf from the tree of life, which is for the healing of the nations. His Bible, His unadulterated Bible, is that leaf. It is for the healing of the people of the nations. God has given to mankind a leaf from the tree of life, which is for the healing of the nations. How can anyone who reads the Scriptures or who has heard them read lose his interest in heavenly things and find pleasure in amusements and enchantments of the world? Manuscript 105, 1901. 14 years after she died, Ellen G. White. Faith and doctrine. Let's discuss a little bit about our doctrines. Ephesians 5, verse, or actually 4, verse 5 and 6. Can you read it with me? One Yahweh, one faith, one baptism, one Elohim and Father of us all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all. That's the correct reading when you read the Bible. But in the Western culture, they went ahead and changed the names into the Bible that we have today. As a pastor, we found out this in seminary school. We looked it up. We asked questions. Well, this is the way it is. But today, now we have Bibles that have the correct names. This is his teachings, theological foundation in your Sabbath school lesson. So in the Sabbath school lesson, he's talking about faith and doctrines, remember? But I want to ask a question to everybody. Are these four key points doctrines in our Bible? And just show up, a show of hands, or just say yes. Is the state of the dead a doctrine? Is the state of the dead a doctrine? Huh? He doesn't know. Okay. Is the state of the dead a doctrine?
Absolutely.
Amen. He knows. The next question, is the Sabbath day a doctrine? You know that. Okay, good. Are we in agreement with that? It's a doctrine. It's a teaching. Number three, the three angels' messages, are they a doctrine? When was the last day you heard it? First, second, three angels' messages, Revelation 14, 6 to 12. Okay? Fourth question, is the sanctuary doctrine that I've been showing here for the last 6 weeks, is it a doctrine? Now, I want to ask you now, who are listening and viewing, can you give these studies to your next door neighbor? Are you ready for it? Because if you're not ready for it, I'd like to share with you that we got a Bible, and the Bible discusses all these doctrines. Ain't that a blessing? In our next study, next page, it says, the Holy Spirit unites the church, the people, the mission work, and service. Is that true? Is that true, ma'am? Does the Holy Spirit unite us in the church and missionary work?
Yes.
Is that true?
Yes.
Does the Holy Spirit unite us in music? Is that true?
Yes.
Okay. Here's the key. Jesus, Yeshua, is waiting to breathe upon all his disciples and give them the inspiration of his sanctifying spirit. That's a blessing. And transfuse the vital influence from himself to his people, to you, to me. He would have them understand that henceforth, they cannot serve two masters. Their lives cannot be divided. Christ is to live in his human agents and work through their faculties, your nervous system, your arteries, your brain, and act through their capabilities. We as a people must be submitted to his will. They must act with his spirit, that it may be no more they that live, but Christ that liveth in them. Jesus is seeking to impress upon them the thought that in giving his Holy Spirit, he has given to them the glory which the Father has given him, that he and his people may be one in God. Our way and will must be in submission to God's will every moment of our lives, knowing that it is only just and good. Can I hear an amen? That's who's doing all the work. Richard's not doing all the work. I'm just the agent so the Holy Spirit can speak to. I want to focus here a little bit, because these are doctrines. These are doctrines that have been forgotten. And the 144,000, I'm going to teach it. If you want your reference for that, you'll find in Review and Note, Volume 1, page 18. Biblical holidays. Christ was crucified on the 14th of Nisan. So April 11th is Passover. It's the week of unleavened bread. Okay? Now, Passover is when Jesus Christ was crucified. The following day on the 15th, which was the Sabbath, which was he was asleep, refers to unleavened bread, his burial. Now, in order for me to share with you Pentecost, I have to go a little back and give you a little history so we understand what's happening and why we need to cry and plead and beg for the baptism of the Holy Spirit so we can go home and be found worthy. Nisan 16, on the third day, first fruits, resurrection. However, 50 days later, a month and a few days, he told them to wait in Jerusalem 10 days. He had already ascended on the 50th day. No, he ascended on the 40th day, and he told them to wait in Jerusalem 10 days. He says, I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit, but I'm going to go to my Father who's going to give it to me, and he's going to breathe upon me the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to inaugurate the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to send it to you. Wait in Jerusalem 10 days. They didn't have the faintest idea of what was coming. You and I don't have the faintest idea of the latter rain and what is coming that you and I need to pray for every moment right now until it happens. And guess what? Now you will be empowered in the character of Jesus Christ, and you will be sealed and ready to be martyred, ready to go to prison, ready to give this message, unadulterated. Do not depend on your denomination. Do not depend on me. Depend on Jesus Christ, nor the government. Everything is closing. Everything is closing. And if you haven't made preparation to get out to the country, to get out to the mountains, let me ask you, get together with those who you belong to, who you get along with, who you can love and live with, and go through these times of sorrows. We're living right in the middle of Matthew chapter 24, verses 6 through 9. Famines, pestilence, wars, rumors of wars, tsunamis, earthquakes, rain, and all hell is breaking loose. And when it breaks, everybody's going to take shelter and going to run their own ways. But the remnant is going to stand fast. And they themselves, no matter what the situation is, are going to sneak in and they're going to give this message. That Jesus Christ is waiting to love you. Repent. No more smooth sermons. That is history. I need to develop this character. The Sabbath school lessons have been a blessing. But we need to dig into it, and you need to dig in and get those gems and pull them out and feed your people in those sermons. It's not about Richard. It's about Jesus Christ. On the day of Pentecost, they were empowered with the Holy Spirit, and all those 120 and the apostles, they had received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That's in your Bibles. That's in the spirit of prophecy. But because of the ignorance of comprehended the Bible, the spirit of prophecy and testimonies to the church were given to us as a people because we were a stiff-necked people.
Amen.
And it smells the stink. This is why we need to be washed. When you were baptized in the Father and the Holy Spirit, that water representing the Holy Spirit cleansed you, and when you came up, you became a new female, a new man. So if you're in the church just because we have the message, well, then you better start pulling out the message, and you better start preaching the message in D.C., L.A., New York, or wherever you claim you want to be. Because I'll tell you this, in these other countries, they are more humbler than us in the United States, that they themselves will do anything they can to hear the message. 3 months later, 90 days later, Feast of Trumpets. And the Feast of Trumpets is when Yahweh declares to the 144,000 who they are, and declares to Jesus Christ to go get his people. Daniel 12, verse 1. 10 days later, Day of Atonement. It's a feast. It's not over with. The books are closed. Richard, how many people did you bring into the church? Ah, but you didn't keep my statutes, Richard. Ah, but look, I brought them into the church. I did what I could. Ah, there's a problem there. You think judgment isn't serious? You better believe it is serious. 5 days later. 5 days later, we come to the Feast of Tabernacles. Redemption, Volume 1, page 93. Read the whole chapter on daily tabernacles. It tells us how the Bible tells us, but it's even elaborate even more how Christ comes on the Feast of Tabernacles, and it takes 7 days to get us home. So is the Holy Spirit in the church? Is the Holy Spirit in you? Is my question. Have you received the baptism of the Holy Spirit? I'd like to ask the congregation to kneel with me. We're going to close in prayer. But before we do that, there is many, many, many things to share. But I want to share with you that I've shared this with you in love and in kindness. I'm not angry, but eager to see a million people be able to stand up right now and start passing out this literature. Start passing out this literature that you yourselves can understand that Christ is coming. I don't have the time or the money, but if you want to know the message, it's right here. It's all right here. I'm giving you $70 worth of books free for you to read at your own time. So that you can understand what the mark of the beast is, understand what the Holy Spirit is, understand what the remnant is, understand what the doctrines are, understand what health is. Health. Health is to be able to speak quietly and discreetly. No. Health is able to us to show and glorify Him in our health and what He's done for us. There's nothing that I've done. It's taken me 25 years to learn this message. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm getting ready to speak more later in other series that you and I can get involved here in Silver Springs and give this message. Go door to door. Leave them at the house. They're going to read it. Jesuits, Catholics, bikers, Hell's Angels, gang members, etc. They're going to read the books, ladies and gentlemen. It's the books that are going to finish the work through you. Amen.